Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the fourth edition of Insights. Insights is an endeavor by Ideas Consulting Group, where we attempt to make complex stories simple. We began in January, when at the height of the farmers' agitation, two experts discussed about the implication of farmers' laws. In the month of February, the month of romance, Valentine, two experts discussed romancing, how to romance brands using digital media, and are we overdoing it? In the month of March, which is where people talk of appraisals and increments and look forward to motivation, we discussed how one could use concepts of behavioral economics and neurosciences to influence behavior of human beings. In this edition today, we are going to talk about something where I must begin by what happened in our country in the third week of March 2020. I remember lockdown was announced for the first time. And the first thing that my wife did was to stock grocery. And she rushed to the nearby market, went to the store where we buy stuff regularly, and tried to buy and hold, if I may use the word, with the uncertainty in front. I noticed two, three things during this phenomenon. First, the brand that I wanted to buy may not have been available in the retailer, and at that moment, retailer, whatever he recommended, we bought. Point number one. Point number two, we noticed that courtesy this pandemic, which was a crisis, it was a big opportunity for many brands to launch their brand extension of sanitizers. Many brands were unknown, local brands. And I remember you go to buy a sanitizer, name for one. The retailer will say, sir, why do you want to pay so much for that? I give you much more of this brand at a lower price. It is as good. Listen to me. So the retailer was replacing the brand which I wanted with his brand that he wanted to push. He would then start giving us combinations. That if you buy so much of this, you will get so much of that additional. I mean, across different categories, there is a basketing which the retailer was doing. And this, I am sure, is not an isolated case that I am discussing. Retail is where the customer finally meets the brand and transacts with the brand. If we look at retail as this definition, then when I was young, one was to see only the Kirana stores. And today, those of you who are millennials will look more at the e-commerce site for buying things than also perhaps the nearby neighborhood store. So we thought that this retailer is playing a pivotal role in marketing of brands for consumer products. And their role has been redefined over the last 10 years, if I may say so. This pandemic, has it made it more important? Have they evolved further? Have the dynamics changed, which is important for marketers to know? So we decided to talk to two experts. And I'm extremely honored and privileged to introduce the two experts on our panel today. Let me first introduce the lady. Sudeshna Ghoshal, she's the founder director. At this moment, she looks after the client development of her own company, Retail Scan Management Services. Retail Scan, to me, provides action at retailers at the fingertips of decision makers, of marketeers, brand managers. Retail Scan does a lot of exciting work. Sudeshna will dig deep into our experience with Retail Scan to talk about retailers and how they are evolving in our discussions today. Prior to what she calls her the entrepreneurial bug biting her, she has worked for extremely prestigious organizations like 3M. So she brings in a wealth of experience with her of having worked with corporate and also now running her own firm in the space for retail. The gentleman who's the other expert, Arshad Siddiqui. Arshad is the founder of a company which is very uniquely named. In fact, I clarified the name. It says Creando, C-R-E-A-N-D-O. I hadn't heard of the word before. It's a French word which means creating. And what Arshad and his company is doing is actually creating value for all the stakeholders in distribution system in this country. Before Arshad started on his own, he was the president and CEO of Rasna Beverages. I mean, Rasna, I still remember, it was a very, very popular drink, especially during summer months. He has worked with organizations, each one of them unique in their own distinct, Balsara, Smith Klein Beecham, Amway, Dr. Maupin, and ITC. It is needless to say, therefore, that both our experts have enough experience, knowledge, expertise, and ground level connect, which I think is most important for the topic that we want to discuss today. Let me begin with Sudeshna and Arshad, both of you, one question. If you could think of the journey that you have sort of undertaken as a sales and distribution expert, I mean, let's look at the period before pandemic. I mean, because pandemic has influenced a lot of things. And if you were to summarize, what are the three key lessons that you have learned in this journey? It could be a great starting point for all of us who are participating in this webinar. Let's go with Sudeshna first. Sudeshna.
Thanks. Great introduction. Liked hearing it from you. Most of my career has been in sales and distribution. And I think the one thing that, because we have quite a few students here also, I understand as participants, that I want to say generally when we talk about sales, the old story comes in our mind, ganje ko kanga bechna. Selling the comb to a bald
man. I hope the pun is unintended.
Apologies, it was not.
Especially with me being with you.
But the one thing that I've learned in my journey is that sales is really not about selling that comb to that bald man. Because if you really sold something to someone which is not, which he will not use, or which he will later find is not useful to him, the relationship is lost, and and the trust is also gone. So sales is really about understanding in a much greater detail the needs of the person, the customer. Sometimes it's a latent need, you don't even, so to understand that need and give a solution to that need. And I think that is the one thing that's the crux of probably what we continue to do now and have done in our lifetimes. One more thing I feel which is very important, because these are certain paradigms which are never taught in our B schools, etc., is that creating a win-win. Because everywhere that you are going, you are partnering, you are creating links. And any point in time that you want to actually distribute, sell, you are moving through links. And the link is likely to break wherever there is a lopsided win at one end. So I think these two are the biggest learnings of life. And if these are implemented, I think most of the work, you would ideally see a lot of success.
In fact, Sudeshna, I mean, what you said is actually extremely important, because whether we look at it, one part is, of course, understanding needs for sales. And the second part, unless it's a win-win relationship, no relationship progresses further.
Absolutely.
And that's true for sales. Arshad, your thoughts? You have to switch. I think you're mute.
You are mute.
You have to unmute yourself, Arshad. I think it's still unmuted. Yeah. Now it's unmuted.
So I'll just take where Sureshta started a story and try and relate selling a comb to a bold man.
Both of you are after me, huh? I'm not
absolutely, we have to. To ensure that you are good with us, not asking questions which you can't. So it's a very interesting thing. Yes, you know, that's the power of a salesman to actually sell any product to any kind of thing. It comes with the relationship that you have with the distributor. That's a relationship that you have with a retailer, and you ensure that you've made your product available. But very important thing is that what she has mentioned is how is your brand delivering to the promise that a salesman has done? Because you can do this thing once, but you cannot do it repeatedly. You know, and over a period of time in my career, I have seen happen to work with various companies, various big brands. Been into an entrepreneur for last 6 years and working with a lot of startup brands. And my core business is sales and distribution. So I have seen that brands, they are flourishing because of distribution, a good and quality distribution, a consistent distribution. And I've seen many brands are wiping out primarily because of distribution. There's no consistency in this thing. Second thing is what my learning has been is that as we go down the pop strata, you know, the influencer of a retailer on consumers start increasing. And the affinity towards the brand start reducing because it's also to do the kind of media penetration that we have over on these towns, right? So these has been my broad learnings working with various companies.
In fact, Arshad, I just pick up from where you said affinity with brands, lower population strata. I've always wondered, Arshad, I've never worked for large FMCG companies like both of you have worked for. It's also for my learning. You know, what influences the retailer's outlook towards the brand? Is it about, what influences it? Is it about brand pool you mentioned about media? Is it about the reputation of the organization? Is it about margins or any other parameter? Because at the end of the day, if only a branded manufacturer could sell, everybody else would have failed. So what is it that creates that affinity, if I may use, of a retailer towards the brand? In your experience, what have you gathered? Because you've worked across the spectrum.
Right. See, all these, every company is being represented by one representative, which is visiting those outlets and servicing that outlet, and the distributor who's servicing those outlets. These two creatures are very important, the salesman and the distributor. Their relationship with the distributor, how you're representing yourself on the retail shelf, okay? How you're providing a solution or a service to a retailer. Yes, of course, the brand pulls plays a very important role. The margin plays a very important role. But the most important thing is the relationship. Now, there are two types of relationship that happens. One is a relationship which is happening between the distributors and a salesman to a retail outlet, because these are the two guys who ensure that you get visibility at a retail outlet. A retailer, as I said, if you go down the pop strata, not so much in metro, they are kind of influencer. And most of these retailers, if you visit these mom and pop stores, is you're actually asking for a brand. So you're not, unlike in a self-service store, you're walking and checking the brand and looking at the packaging and picking up the product. Here you're asking a product. So the brand becomes very important. In that time, a retailer plays a very important role in influencing and generating trials for you.
Right. Sudeshna, you have been working with many FMCG brands. I mean, HUL, ITC, Benckiser, what is that? Glaxo, Smith Kline, which I'm, you know, and you offer a variety of services, not only to kirana stores or general trade. You also offer it to chemists for the OTC pharma. In your experience at retail scan, what are the type of insights which you have gathered about the thinking of the retailers, how they think and orient themselves to brands, and how do you sort of what is important for brand owners to understand so that they can leverage it for better strategy? Any case study you would like to share, whichever way you want to take this question.
So I think I can pull this from, you know, what Arshad said sometime back. Let us look at a life of a retailer. He gets up in the morning, opens his store, and his entire day is full of transactions. Chota, small transactions that he does. It's accumulation of all these transactions. Now, obviously, his affinity will be for the products which consumer walks in and asks for. The consumer sells. Jo jaldi bikta hai, that is what interests him, that is what excites him most. But having said that, okay, let us also understand that if this product is not available to him, or if this product is not delivered, or the manufacturer of the product is not able to meet the expectations or the promises made to the retailer, the retailer himself is irate, and the retailer himself will work towards, you know, not making but breaking the brand. So in my experience itself, I've seen actually there are, you know, very large organizations. They've created a retailer loyalty program, has all the, you know, benefits to for the retailer. There is an incentive on share gain, incentive on target achievement, incentives on display, etc. But when it comes, this was all created by people in the AC room. When it comes, translates through a channel down to the retail level of the retailer, okay, there are systemic or implementation flaws that happen. I have seen retailers have just not understood what was the entire construct or what was promised to him. You know, it has been given as a discount to him. So even if the money has come or the benefit has come to him, he's not understood that. So it's also about communicating to the retailer, you know, this entire gamut that was built for him. And what is the communication, mode of communication? The channel, of course. The last mile people who are meeting him. And of course, to facilitate this for manufacturers, we've also created, you know, apps where now with technology, you can have a process where you can directly, manufacturer can go directly and inform the retailer, whether it's schemes, programs, you know, benefits, loyalty programs, etc. So the point again, it comes back to the same thing. Have you created a win for the retailer? And have you communicated well to him? These are the two things that also impact the retailer's attitude towards the product or the brand, besides the intrinsic brand pull that's there in the system. There are cases where locally retailers have gone ahead and made or, you know, broken or, you know, even made a brand because of the loyalty that they have to the brand.
In fact, you know what? What I learned from both of you is that margins are something which somebody will give me some little more margin, somebody will give me less margin, because the margin also depends how much customer is going to pay for the brand. That is very transactional. But I think what I am gathering from both of you, what you are saying, is it's relationship. It is transparency. It is about communication. It is about service levels.
Absolutely.
I have a demand for a product X or brand X, and I'm not getting the supply. That is actually ruining not only brand X in the long run, it is ruining me as a retailer first. So I think there is much more to just financial gains and losses in terms of these affinity, in terms of this support or destruction, whichever way it is that we talk of retailers. I just have a very big curiosity, you know, both of you, you have seen this evolution from Kirana GT stores to now you have full page ads in the cover page of newspapers that you can buy so much atta, they cut off like 500, comes at 200 and things like that, the e-commerce part of it. So this journey from that neighborhood store to e-commerce and all in between, modern trade, you have got others. I mean, what are the opportunities and challenges that you are seeing in this evolution that we are seeing in this space for the consumer products? Arshan, let me ask you first, and then Sudeshna could add to it.
Right. So if you look at with the advent of modern trade and e-commerce pumping a lot of money, and they essentially started with electronics and now getting into a grocery and FMCG and literally everything. Of course, there is a channel conflict which is happening. Okay, so if I go, it always happens, you and us, that if you're buying something, we go and see the physical product there and then go and check on Amazon, what is the price, and then we look at it. Okay, modern trade tends to give this whole ad in the newspaper that, okay, this particular brand.
Yeah, exactly.
Of course, that has created a lot of issues in the market when it comes to retailer. However, yes, both the channels have grown and both the channels are growing, but the role of a mom and pop store continues to play whatever they were doing that. The opportunity which most of the brand people have not leveraged these channels differently, because it is very important that if you observe that when a customer goes to a mom and pop store versus a consumer when we walk into modern trade and an e-commerce, okay, when he goes to a modern trade and e-commerce, he's more likely to try newer brands, a different SKUs. He's looking for something different. So that is an opportunity where most of the brand has not managed to leverage that part of it, where they're creating products and brands specific for modern trade or e-commerce. So there's a huge opportunity there. So it is not, most of the companies are looking at this as a supplementing channel, not creating a new channel and a new product centric for this channel.
Okay, so you mean to say that both will coexist?
Both will coexist. Both will coexist. And see, we look at whenever we look at distribution in India, we have to not look at from a Delhi Mumbai perspective. We have to look at people beyond Delhi and Bombay. Because see, as you go down the pop strata, going to a retail shop and buying that 2 rupees sachet is actually an activity or an entertainment for a consumer to go and buy it, take that and go and take a bath. Versus when both husband and wife are working, they want somebody to deliver milk on their doorstep. Milk, bread and butter. So there are companies who are specializing that, okay, morning maybe we'll ensure that you have milk and butter at doorstep. But those things cannot happen in other parts of the country.
Sudeshna, your thoughts?
Yeah, I see, the entire GT, the mom and pop store, also evolving a lot. For example, in the pandemic time, while people did go to the the e-commerce platforms, etc., organized formats, they could not go because most of these are in malls, etc. Some of them, of course, made an attempt to come to your building premises and all of that happened. But ultimately, if you look at it, for your basic groceries, you have only dependent on the local Kirana store, the one that you get it from. That is because he also knows your buying habits. He knows the variant and SKU that you may buy. And he would probably also keep an inventory because he knows in that interland, what are the, typically the variant sizes, packs, flavors that sell. Of course, in this time, we have seen a lot of GT evolving in terms of their hygiene, their way of, and the commitment to actually come and deliver. In the urban areas, urban metropolitan areas like Bombay, Delhi, which Arshad said, I think the GT is going to play an ever-increasing role because of those general trade stores who have actually evolved to that level. in the rural, besides GT, there is no other. That's the outlet. That's where you go. I mean, for a you know, in the corners of Ratnagiri, you'll never have you know, a large format store going and opening up shop there. So GT will continue to play a very, very strong role in India, unless and until the entire, you know, there's a complete paradigm shift in which we don't see happening, which at least I don't see happening.
Another thing that I've seen, I'm talking about metro towns, they are also evolving and trying to be in line with consumer requirements. So most of these mom and pop stores have created those apps or a WhatsApp services.
Absolutely.
That you don't have to go there, you can just you know, order it. So there is a comfort that, okay, I know this stock is coming from there, and I don't have to walk into that store. So Indian, some of the retailers are also evolving themselves to this new competition.
Absolutely. They've taken, you know, payment like GPay, you know, all these wallet kind of payments.
They are actually
delivering and getting it. The other thing that is there, which I definitely see happening in the market, look at the urban population. I mean, there was a time when the entire family was sitting and watching television together. Okay, and therefore getting exposed to ads of products, Pepsi, Coke, and all of this, right? Today, each one is watching his own stuff on Netflix or Prime, Amazon, in his own device, computer, phone, television, etc. So if you see the advertising at one point in time where the print media, I mean, there are many well-educated homes who do not have a newspaper nowadays. Anyway, the newspapers have become very thin and, you know, there's hardly much meat there. But the print media is becoming very, very, you know, old and obsolete slowly. So therefore, where can you get a real-life experience of all the products? It's in the store.
You know, in fact, I am reminded of two things. I must narrate this personal incident. We live in a place called Salt Lake in Kolkata, which is pretty modern and well, it's one of those planned areas.
Upwardly mobile areas, if my message is.
All right. So the area is divided into blocks and every block has its own market.
Sure.
And we have been buying our groceries from a retailer which is in the nearest block market. About 3-4 years back, Big Bazaar opened a store in Salt Lake. So I told my wife that we should go to Big Bazaar to do our monthly grocery. We will save some money, discounts, this Big Bazaar. She had a very interesting take on it. She said, first of all, that discounts is not as much as you think because you're not factoring in the cost of petrol to go there and buy. Honestly, I have not thought of it. And the second thing was more important. She says that I am cooking a dish and suddenly I open the dumper and I find I am short in one of those items. At that time, I can call this guy. He will rush me a packet. Your Big Bazaar will never do it. I said, it's not my Big Bazaar. If I were, you would also be lucky. So the point is, the customer has an emotional connect with the nearby grocery store and that guy also tries to reciprocate. He gives the credit. For a monthly purchase, once in a month you play. You just order, I'll send it, and in a month I will pay. So these are things which perhaps a modern retail cannot do, or an e-commerce cannot do. The other thing, Sudeshna, and here I want your and Rashad's input. If I look at a modern retail or an e-commerce as a customer, I can see every brand on my screen or on the shelf. Am I right? However, in a mom and pop store, you have an opening like this. And only things which are hanging in front of you can see. So how is this visibility thing getting tackled in mom and pop store, which I think is important because there could be brands which are not visible, people may not strike it. How are the best people strategize to tackle this visibility? Do you think it's a problem and then how does one tackle it? Anyone of you can go first.
Okay. See, if you look at, as you rightly said, you know, we classify A class outlet, B class outlet, and C class outlet. Okay, and especially if you travel to Kerala or any of the south market, so you see the same shop selling banana, and you can't even see the person is all surrounded by all kind of things.
Absolutely right.
And if you look at from a sales perspective, maybe he's giving me same sales as what a volume class A outlet is doing it, right? So hence these outlets becomes very important. Having said that, yes, every company, and Sudeshna is in that area, can throw more light, looking for solutions to ensure your brand is visible, after all those hangers. But here, the consumer pull and the relationship of your retailers and all those things, they know which brand that you want, they are likely to give you that brand, okay? So that is, yes, when it comes to new brands, it's a challenge. Doing any kind of visibility in those kind of outlets is a big challenge.
Sudeshna, your take on this visibility?
There's one point that I agree with Marsha, that the local mom and pop store is where you have an emotional connect. He knows you as a person. He knows the family for a long time. So he would ideally, if there is a new brand that has come in, he would also dole out, madam, ye bhi milta hai. Ye naya aya hai, try karke dekhi. Okay. So it is a one-on-one connect that sells. But having said that also, now if you see, especially in the urban areas, you have the neighborhood standalone supermarkets, you have the large format, general merchant stores, as we call them, which are selling packaged food, packaged data, packaged stuff, and not the typical kirana who sells loose, atta, dal, chawal, and so on. Those are the stores where we see, the key brands being huddled together on, shelves, where from the customer point of view, which has some visibility. So this association also builds a lot in making of a new brand that has come into the market. So I've come out with a new, washing powder, and I can get it placed beside Tide and Ariel, likelihood that the association will build that this is of the similar, quality. Of course, detergent is not so much of an involved sales, but very true for personal care products. So the point I'm making here is that there is both. There is an emotional connect and a direct pitch by the retailer. At the same time, now in urban areas, you do have stores where there is some amount of visibility that is also there. That's also possible.
Sudeshna, I just pick up from where you mentioned that if you have a new brand of detergent, you place it next to an Ariel or a Tide and things like that, and you get a visibility as well as a sort of a rub off, if I may say so. So as brand managers, as marketing professionals, I mean, I'm sure the retailer must be incentivized to put that pack where you as a brand manufacturer want it to. I'm asking the question more from a marketing perspective, from a marketing manager's perspective. I mean, retailers get incentivized. So what are the new forms that you both of you are seeing in terms of incentivizing retailer? And how can one differentiate here to get more out of whatever investment one is making in the incentive that we're creating for retailers? I mean, I'll ask both of you, you could use some examples, case studies, if anything comes right up the mind regarding this retailer's incentive and motivation.
Okay, so there are various incentive programs which are being run for retailers, and every company does that. Okay, some are giving a straight discount, some are giving those trips. Some people are giving it as utility items. Okay, end of the day, any CRM is successful when there is a proper rotation of a retailer stock which is happening, because that is very, very critical. Because everything that we do, please understand, any strategy that we implement has been strategy gets implemented by the lowest rung in an organization. Okay, how they do it, what kind of service they are doing it, what kind of commitment they are doing it, because everybody is running for a target, and somewhere where we tend to do mistakes, where we don't place the right product at the right outlet. So yes, you may see a spike, but is this product suitable for that outlet is a big question mark. Okay, what kind of conversion that you are looking at? Because you know, one of the things that we are doing is that we are aggregating distribution space, and we are also trying to segregate different kinds of outlets for different kind of brands. It is not that every brand can be there, whatever. So it is important that make that focus of a retailer or a certain set of high selling SKUs, and ensuring that he's continue to have those kind of products and those kind of brands to have a better ROI.
Okay. So Krishna, your take?
Yeah, so while the mix of the brands are the retailer would also like to keep brands in a band. So he would have at various price points. But the point is that at the end of the day, at each price point, there would be some brands which are moving faster and there's those which are laggards. Right. Now the retailer is ideally interested in those brands which are moving faster, because again, what Varshad said, he has to be worried about how fast he's rotating his wallet. So therefore, ideally, even in this small space that he would have, he would still have the situation where he is putting, you know, the newer brands along with the fast moving brands to see, because the more number of fast movers he has, the better for him. The profile of the store is, of course, the key to, for example, there are certain stores where a double income person would ideally walk in and would try to take, you know, all these packaged foods, etc. Packaged foods, packaged masalas, ready to make cook is ideally to be put in this kind of store. A lot of time, the primary mistake that happens is that you put the product in a store which is not in the right profile.
Correct.
And that is where the inventories will build up.
Yeah, in fact, I remember at one point of time, I used to hear my classmates who were in the FMCG space would say that they will ride new products or so-called laggards piggyback on the fast mover. Like if you want so many cartons of fast moving, you have to buy a couple of cartons of slow moving or laggard. Is that practice still prevalent, Arshad?
Absolutely prevalent. It is absolutely prevalent. In fact, we have, I will not like to name the brand, but one of the very large brands, which is very popular, the manufacturer put at least 3 laggards along with it during the pandemic and said, ye agar lena hai, to itna, these also will have to go. You will have to
pick it still there. So Arshad, your experience
said, very, very prevalent.
So yes, what she said is absolutely right. But there's another strategies which companies are also doing. Is what happens is that, for example, a Unilever brand is a Unilever brand, no matter how big or small that brand is. Okay. So yes, you have one set of consumer distributors who are selling your top items. There are other set of distributors who are willing to take your product, which are low-selling product, but that becomes very important for those kind of distributors. And it is same thing happens that when he's going, it is his interest to ensure that number of outlets are increased, because it's a very difficult balance to have, because a salesman has a value target, which he chases no matter what he sells.
Correct.
Distribution company wants numeric distribution, weighted distribution, everything. Yeah. Okay. So that is where these companies have adopted to the level that has the same brand have 4 SKUs. So the 2 SKUs are being taken by one set of distributors, and 2 SKUs are given to the another set of distributors.
Is it for creating focus?
It is to create focus. It is to create a different footprint. Because what happens is that end of the day, retailer is the king. He decides what comes in his retail outlet. And at times he says that, boss, I don't want to take this product. I don't want to take this product if you're giving me this product.
Okay.
So that also happens to overcome this thing. Because see, again, now if you lose that customer for your star brand, you're likely to have an impact on your distribution. So they say he might as well give it to somebody else who will at least go and push into certain outlets which currently are not doing it.
You know what? The retailer is the king, and the lady of the house is the queen. And I think that's the situation which we have to live with. One of the things which I notice that, let's say, every pack has an MRP printed on it, right? And in the same market, different retailers will sell it at a different price to the customer. I have noticed this, and perhaps this is not an exception. Now, looking at it from a brand strategy point of view, what is it that the brand strategists can do to sort of try and sort of keep that market operating price, if I may say so, within a particular band? Otherwise, whatever little marketing I know, if the brand price to the customer fluctuates in a very wide sort of spectrum, it is not good for the brand. I mean, do you both see this, and how do you tackle it? What happens here? I mean, something which intrigues me a lot. Achha?
I think this is products or the brands need to be divided into two categories. One are the typically the commodities. One are the non-commodities. Let us look at the chips.
What do you mean commodities?
Or commodities are typically atta, oil.
But we have branded atta pulses, like Ashirwad and Ganesh and all those are branded. No, I agree. Pulses, Sudeshna. What about atta? Atta, you have an Ashirwad, you have a Ganesh, you have this and that.
But it's a commodity, right? Ultimately.
Okay.
All.
So is it oil. Looked at? I don't know. I'm asking.
Whether it's atta or rice, you have packaged it and tried to give it a form, a brand form, and tried to say this brand form stands for these goodies or these good or bad, these goodies or these strengths. But ideally, if you look at it, the non-commodity products, which are typically like, say, a chips or a noodles, take the case of Maggi, for example. Mm-hmm. Maggie started with a 10 rupee pack because that is a price point at which, you want to have a snack for 10 rupee, go get a Maggie and you have your evening snack is over. So when they wanted to increase the price for a long time, we know that they have gone ahead and decreased the volume, decreased the grammage, decreased the amount of material to keep the 10 rupees on. Till almost last year, they have in certain markets gone and taken it to a 12 rupee, trying to create a 12 rupee price point now. But with the commodities, what happens is typically that the manufacturer at the time, commodities are usually driven by the time that the products are harvested. And so this is the time, whether it's tea, whether it's atta, that is wheat, when the product is harvested and it is brought in and the manufacturer is actually creating and packaging it, they have created a lot, but it will have a particular shelf life. So these are the times, like, for example, when wheat is produced, wheat is likely to be sold. When it's a bumper crop, the price usually does come down. Similarly, the packaged product, although they have tried to give it a brand form, would ideally like to come down as well. And we have seen the MOPs varying to a level of 35-40%, 50% from the MRP, the printed MRP.
But that's not good for the brand, no, Sudeshna?
Obviously, I mean, I have always said that, why is that band created? But that is, again, because they know that, this can be kept only packaged atta has an expiry at the end of the day. So similarly, if you see, you look at some of the e-commerce platforms, you will get the same, atta at a much lesser price there, perhaps, than you get it. And, it was creating a dissonance. And then we found out that most of the time, because of the strength of the pocket of an e-commerce or a large format, they would ideally buy a lot of these close to expiry stock. So the stock is likely to expire in a month's time. They have bought, 100, 200 quintals of that per store. And as a result, what has happened is that product they have got at a much lesser price and therefore selling at a much lesser price.
So that's more of a liquidation strategy.
Yeah, but that is definitely a dampener for the brand. once if you are used to getting Ashirvad, I mean, Pampers, there's a case study in Kotler that, you know, once you are used to getting a product at a particular price, you'd never like to pay a higher price for that same brand.
Arshad, your take on this, and to the participants, please start asking your questions. We are moving towards the last 15 minutes of the session. Please type them out in the chat box, and our experts will be happy to take them.
Yeah. So I happen to handle certain brands which you're talking about has never sold on MRP. Okay. So yes, there was always a challenge. And as a company, as a brand owner, this cannot be corrected overnight, because wherever the brand, as Sudeshna said, either a commodity or a product which has a high passive distribution. Passive distribution means the wholesaler contribution is much higher. That's where the product selling on MRP is very, very difficult. So it is.
What is the correlation, Sarshan, for the participants? If you could explain, when the wholesaler numbers are more, it is difficult. What is the correlation in this comment?
So the wholesaler is actually a person between a retailer and a distributor.
Right.
So he is also a kind of distributor, because he supplies it to a very, very small set of retail outlets who actually walk in the morning, take their day's supply, go back and put their shop and sell. There are certain wholesalers who have their set beats, and they go and distribute because they have set of certain outlets. Because what a wholesaler does, that he has he's supplying 20 or 30 items to a retailer. Okay, so there is a certain amount of discount that he's able to pass on to these retailers. These wholesalers plays a very important role in the entire distribution gamut. So most of the company tends to give a higher margin to them. Wholesaler, if you give whatever percentage, they will just keep 1.5% and cut in the market. There is so much of competition. They know that, okay, it is a... So when it comes to commodity, they always look at, are gehun ka dam 70 rupay hai, aap ye 80 rupay mein kyun bech rahe ho? 50 rupay lagta hai. They do these calculations. And this is a company, they do it, put that MRP and try and push the people to start buying it towards MRP. But it is a very long process. It does affect a brand image. And I've seen certain brands struggling when they move from passive to active channel. Their actual sale has gone down, but over a period of time, they managed to come back to the same level.
Any strategies that you both have seen for brands to take to tackle these things?
So I can give a Ashirvad Atta.
Okay.
Handled ITC. So over a period of time, what they have educated retailers, he starts selling on MRP, it is a higher margin for you. Why are you discounting it? Okay. We are doing so much of advertising and generating consumer demand, where people coming and asking for it, then might as well do that. So there is a discounting that happens on a mass scale, or retailers are known for giving at a discounted price. Another thing is, there are set customers of these retailers who always get a privileged price. So that you can't change. But over a period of time for this thing, we have worked with the retailers and continuously pushing over the years to start selling Ashirvad on MRP.
In fact, you know, Arshad, when you spoke about special customers, I remember when you said, it struck me. My wife buys grocery from one store, but she buys everything to do with personal, that hair, shampoo, soap, from another store. They've asked her, why do you buy from two different stores? This fellow also keeps it. She says, no, there I get a minimum discount on all brands which this fellow doesn't give. So I think what you mentioned just now, I can relate it to my what is happening at home. And you know, my question is here is, both all of us agree that the retailer who's the mom and pop store has this connect with customers, and he has a set of loyal customers, right? And those customers will not run away to another retailer just for the sake of a couple of rupees and 5 rupees here. Even then, why does this fellow not try to monetize himself for a higher margin by selling closer to MRP? Do you have any reason
so that, now, as I said, there are people who are now working, and a lot of companies, because one of the brands that we work is like continuously educating to these retailers that why are you giving up your margin? You know, why are you selling it? Because it affects the entire dynamics, and it also creates ki ye duplicate to nahi hai. Haan mil raha hai to duplicate to nahi hai. So wo bhi ek problem aata hai.
I would like to add here, I also notice a different behavior of the retailer since the pandemic time. The retailer himself has started buying from e-commerce and B2B kind of platforms, right? So there is Udaan, there are people like these. So they are, I would say, large format wholesalers, so to say. Now, if they are, if the retailer is able to get the product at 2 rupees less, he doesn't mind to acquire a customer by keeping his margin constant, therefore selling it at a 1 rupee less price. So that's another reason why you see that retailers are, because they have to be competitive in the hinterland, which they are serving. So, because now is the time when I see the Walmart's coming in and other cash and carry formats, Reliance Smart coming in, they are able to get products which otherwise from the distribution system, they would have probably not got at the same rate.
Let me take our first question at this stage. The first question is from Soumya Sehgal. Thank you, Soumya, for asking the question. The question is, with absence of in-store footfall during the pandemic, how brands / retailers promote newly launched products? Interesting question, Chumbo. Experts.
Okay. Here I want to add one thing that during pandemic, okay, we all talked about policemen, we talk about doctors, we talk about nurses, paramedics, but we forgot about our retailer.
Absolutely.
Because when the pandemic happened, when the lockdown happened, he was the only one who was giving you a product when you wanted. If you put it on Amazon, it will take 3 days. Whether it come or not, you don't know. Do they have a courier service? Don't know. So this guy had always had more footfall during pandemic than the e-commerce and modern trade. So initial period, if you look at between March, April, May, June, April, May, June, July, when this pandemic was at peak, the retailers were actually servicing colonies, areas, and the question that you ask, in fact, I've seen one of the brands, Jaggery brand, so I'm associated with Dhampur Speciality Sugar as an independent director. Their product was not available, and somebody from Noida has launched a Jaggery because everybody's talking about immunity, and he ensured that product is available. And he has created a customer now, and he's doing better than Dhampur in those markets. So there are people who have taken advantage of this pandemic, have ensured, because at that time, whatever is available, I want Jaggery, I want Atta. Ashirwad is not there. Achha, theek hai, give me some other Atta. At least I'll have something to eat. So their brand was not important. The product category was important. So there are a lot of people who have taken advantage of this pandemic.
The number of phenyl brands which came up during that time, amazing. Everybody had a phenyl because you wanted to do all this disinfection.
Everybody has a hand sanitizer.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So Deshna, anything you would like to add to the answer which Arshad gave, or should I move to the next question?
I think we'll move to the next question, yes.
Okay. So this question is from Gargi, who asks, I still do not get how big e-retailers still manage to make a profit by handing out such huge discounts, which we do not otherwise get from other retail outlets. Or from a retailer perspective, I know that a brand is selling at its MRP from a store, why would I choose to give a 40% discount? I think what Gargi is trying to ask is, how does the equation work for these retailers? I mean, I'm sure you have the insights.
Thanks. That is a very nice question to ask. The bigger the retailer, the bigger is his power to negotiate from the manufacturer and get the product. So believe me, when it's a Reliance Smart, okay, buying from a Procter and Gamble, okay, you probably they are buying at 70% lesser price than what it will land in your with your retailer. So here, please do not go by my percentage. That's not important. The point that I'm trying to make here is the bigger the retailer, the bigger his pocket, the more ability for him to arm twist or negotiate rather with the manufacturer and get a rate that makes him competitive in the market. And that is why we are now seeing a lot of retailers, your neighborhood retailers, not buying from distributor, but going and buying from a cash and carry format, simply because for everything, he is probably getting 2 rupees, 3 rupees lesser. Or for those products that he's getting lesser, is buying from the cash and carry.
Arshad, your thoughts?
See, so there is one aspect which Sureshna said. Another aspect is every distributor every retailer look at their ROI, how fast they are able to rotate their funds. You know, so at times the inventory holding cost affects their ROI, and hence they pass on the discount, liquidate that, rotate the fund faster. So that is one of the reason they give a higher discount. Reliance being a big, but these two retailers who are also have a significant business, they also get a couple of percentage here and there, which they use it look at. Second thing is that every retailers, when they look at their ROI, they look at from the branded and the non-branded items, how much is a branded and non-branded item. So if in a branded item you are making X, and unbranded items, you will be making X plus 10%. Correct. So that is actually, you transfer it into a branded product.
Perhaps they look at the overall profitability rather than brand-wise profitability.
Right.
Okay, we are coming towards the last 5 minutes of our discussion. You know, one of the things which this pandemic has impacted, Arshad and Sudeshna, is this digital adoption of a common consumer. I mean, a lot of people have suddenly become digitally savvy. You mentioned, Sudeshna, about people using platforms like Google Pay, Paytm, and others to pay. Some of the retailers are creating apps, as Arshad mentioned, to sort of connect with the local community. And we read about big brands who are trying to look at this mom and pop store and sort of getting them on a platform. Given all this, given this pandemic, which I was at least hoping that things will come move for the better, seems to have gone down now, next 2 years will be very, very crucial. So how do you both see the future of retailer, their importance in the next 2 years, given all these changes that are taking place, the amount of uncertainty which is around? What are the trends that you are noticing? Whoever wants to go first.
Okay, so one of the trends that we have observed here is that young adult generation who was a little apprehensive in using an e-commerce to use e-commerce as a platform buying products have increased because they didn't have time. So the only time that they had, okay, let me explore that option. So one of these people who had as a entertainment to going to a shop buying it is now moved to e-commerce. Has the business got really affected in the FMCG space, the industry that I represent? Yes, there was a certain amount of shift happened, but it is coming back to mom and pop store. What has happened for the e-commerce thing, because these generation who are not exploring this particular channel have got hooked onto it. So they are exploring with newer and newer category and newer different kind of products. May not be the product that they use on a daily basis, but they're exploring new and innovative products. So anything which is new and different, they are trying those products, which they couldn't have tried when they were dealing with mom and pop stores.
So therefore, Arshad, are you saying that e-commerce could be perhaps a more logical way of launching a new product or extension or a category?
Of course, in the certain categories, as I said, certain categories, the kind of leverage that you can get on your e-commerce, because see, the most important thing for any brand is visibility. Okay. Now, if I go to Amazon, I'm assured of certain people looking at my product at least. To get the same level of people looking at on a retail space will require a humongous infrastructure. So I've seen a lot of startups and a lot of people who I know, they've started their business through e-commerce and now they are coming into retail.
Oh, it's the other way around,
you know.
Great.
See, e-commerce is at the end of the day can give you your targeted audience. So right. Typically, if somebody were to launch a cream which is very specific for a particular age group, for a particular category of people, it is better to, they would ideally go the e-commerce way, because then you are absolutely targeting to your right people. And then once the trials have been generated, you take it to the mass market level. Mass market at the end of the day needs deeper pockets. So taking it to mass market. But one thing that I wanted to mention, Deepak, here is that the question on what is the going to be the future of retail. See, at the end of the day, we have been having this onslaught of e-commerce, etc. But nonetheless, the fact remains that people want to have the touch feel of the product. People want to see. I've personally been involved in a furniture, e-commerce platform. And I've seen that, people love to touch, feel, see, experience, and then buy. So at the end of the day, if there is a product which is absolutely, there is no involvement, okay, then it's a different thing. But then there's a category of person who will also be involved in the toilet cleaner of the house, in the floor cleaner of the house. So there are various people have various level of involvements. I think the process of touching, feeling, and buying the product remains. The mom and pop store, the GT, gives you a convenience which no other platform can give, because they know you, they know you as a person. There are many a times we all know that they are also giving credit in the hinterland. So there will be families where, in a month they will get homes. So that's a huge convenience for that family. So I think the general trade is something, the mom and pop store is something that is going to be there, especially in a country like India where, which is so vast.
Elsewhere also, I don't see that they will vanish, but they have to reinvent themselves. One question which is coming very interesting, Saksham Kulshrestha. Thank you, Saksham, for asking the question. What steps do you think a brand should take to counter the inaccurate inventory cycle count in the secondary sales? Any suggestion apart from technological upgradation? So the one part of this, I think both of you are experts on this one. I think very pertinent question, Saksham. Thank you for that.
Yes. Okay, so yes, one of the things that we realize in this is out of stock happening at a retail level. Okay, so one of the things that, yes, of course, without technology, it is very, very difficult, because, like we cover about 2 lakh outlets. So knowing what is the stock available at that point of time without a technology is very, very difficult. In fact, we are working on a very interesting project on that. So without a technology, it is very difficult. But on an experience, we did a small study, and we have seen that there are brands that loses about 10 to 15% of their sales due to non-availability of right stock at a retail outlet or out of stock situation. Because we have a weekly cycle or a fortnightly cycle. So if you're not tracking it, you have out of stock situation and you're losing about 10 to 15% of sale.
Lishna, any thoughts?
Yes, in the without technology, tracking it is difficult. But at the end of the day, I think now the industry is making a lot of effort to understand this secondary. Part of the secondary actually comes in with the DMS, the distributor management software, because what happens is, let us assume a retailer, I mean, I I'm trying to make it as simple as I can for Saksham. Assuming that a retailer is turning his inventory two times in a month, okay? So if he is buying from the distributor twice, right? The distributor management software, which the manufacturer has installed in that distributor's office, the product is getting billed through that. So that gives a reflection of what is the secondary that has happened in the store. Yes, it is dependent on how well that is being managed, because managing this kind of software is only a facilitator. What you put in the software is what comes out as a result in a report. So if there is, you are tweaking with it, if the distributor is, if you're not managing, if the manufacturer is not able to manage it well, and building the security systems, et cetera, that ensures that everything is built through the software itself, the picture could be skewed. But it is not that it is cannot be done at all. It is done. I think now, in the last 10 years, we have seen huge shift towards secondary. There was a point in time in the FMCG or any other industry, it was primary that was allowing the sales team to earn its incentives on. So the sales team was incentivized on the primary sale, and now it's the secondary figures also that comes. And you know, the if you are measuring the secondary sales, and if you are measuring the person responsible for secondary sales on that metric, then obviously that will be measured and reviewed.
In fact, Shakshavita, Sudeshna and Arshad both make a very important and pertinent point. Technology is only an enabler. If you do not sort of follow discipline in terms of using technology, nobody can help you. So it also depends on the organization's might, on the organization's intention to capture data, and more importantly, use it effectively in terms of supplying the market so that the stockout situations are minimized. If there is a benefit, then only there will be people who will sort of cooperate in this entire supply chain from factory to the consumer's hands. So that is very, very key. One question to both the experts. There are many students who have found your subject interesting. I know some of them are there in the participant today. If one wants to make a career in sales and distribution, what are your tips in terms of the opportunities? How should one prepare oneself? And whatever will help the students to look at sales and distribution. I'm not talking marketing, because everybody is very happy doing some fancy advertising and all those planet. A lot of people are willing. But hardcore sales and distribution, what are the type of things that you look for? And what should people prepare themselves for this career? Who will go first?
So like the way we look at it, obviously, it is important that person should be because sales is not sitting in an AC room. Because most of the MBA, like me also, we thought that once I'm out of MBA Institute, I'll have a cabin and I'll have a laptop and a sexy
secretary. I'll also have a secretary who will take dictation during our days if we got.
And my induction happened in Cholapur, where we had to stay in a lodge. So that was a shift. But having said that, the real learning comes from, because if you don't understand where the brand and consumer interaction is happening, how this entire dynamics work, you're not able to make a career in sales and distribution. You have to understand a life of a salesperson. You have to understand a life of a distributor. You have to understand what happens in the field if you want to make your career. You should, it's all about hard work. It's all about being on the street. That is what sales and distribution is all about. How to build relationship, your interpersonal skills, how analytical you are, how problem solution this thing, because every outlet that you go will have a different and a unique problem. And nothing in this world can be, you know, put down into an SOP. Okay, this is a standard operating procedure. Because when you're talking about 12 million outlets, there are 12 million problems.
If not more. Sudeshna, your thoughts?
Yeah, so I think Arshad has sort of put it very well. It's all about hard work, because unless and until you've been on the street and seen it all, and experienced it all, you know, you'd never know. One thing is, I think attitudinally, one has to shift to a paradigm of trying to create that win-win. I think that is something that I started this discussion with. But I really feel this because I feel in Indian context, many a times, you know, the attitude is that the other person should, I should win big. The other person should, if he wins, he should win small. Okay. But distribution is all about partners, because you will never be able to reach, whether it's a service or a product, without a chain. And the chain is, will only work if every link in the chain is happy. And that is, products are actually made by how well, of course, there has to be some strength in the product, but how well is this chain moving? So the faster the product reaches the market is, it's like a, you know, it's a, I can draw a parallel with the baton race. How fast is the baton being handed from one person to the other is when you lose, when you win the race. And that is where, that's an attitudinal, I think, shift that, you know, that this, these new students have to bring in.
In fact, with the permission of both of you, I would like to add my take on this. I think first and foremost, if you don't enjoy selling, you will never be able to succeed. You have to enjoy walking. You will not find aircrafts. You have to travel by rickety buses, stinking train compartments, non-AC four-wheelers, all the works. That's first point. Second point, and I can tell you, is one of the things that I have found is missing and is lacking in many MBA students is they look down upon retailers. They think ye to unpad hai, illiterate hai, main MBA hoon. They start operating from this. No, it should be the other way around. He is the man who can make you in sales. You cannot do nothing without him. The second thing. And the third thing, Arshad spoke about Sholapur, am I right? You began your career. One of my classmates joined a company called Madura Coats. At that point of time, it used to sell threads. And in 1987, the year we graduated, 31st December, at that time, there was no email, no phones. He wrote a very sentimental letter to me. He says, I am in some obscure village in Tamil Nadu on 31st evening. I can't even pronounce the name of the place. My company is our old friend, the old monk, and myself. I am spending 31st night uniquely, but that is the attitude. That is the spirit one intended that one needs to have if one really wants to succeed in sales and distribution as a career. But let me tell you one thing. If you really want to succeed in marketing, you must go through sales and distribution, because that is when you will have the feel of what's happening at the soil, at the ground level. And that is what is going to build careers. If you want to make a career in marketing, start with sales and distribution. The higher knowledge, the more exposure that one will get on markets, that is going to help you when you sit in an AC room and think brand strategies. So the final one, Sudeshna and Arshad, do you, what is your take on the role of retailer in brand building? Is it going to increase, remain the same, decrease? And that's the key of this webinar today.
Of course, I mean, as the number of players are coming in and the number of SKUs are increasing at a retail level, the role of a retailer will always be there in any kind of brand building, you know. And of course, it will increase because he's engaging with far more consumers on a daily basis than any of the e-commerce or a modern trade on a daily basis.
Sudeshna?
And the trial, the generation, you know, trial generation is something that can be best handled by these retailers, because there are three, you know, bottles of a new juice which has come into the market, kept at the, on the, ye naya nikla hai. This is a new one. This is a healthier one. Those two, three lines, you believe in him. The retailer
is... Maine bhi piya hai, sir. Bahut badi hai. Peel ke dekhiye. Maine bhi piya
hai. So that last minute prod, purchase at the end of the day, we must realize is 50% impulse. And that is where the retailer gives you that last minute push to you know, trigger that 50% impulse in you. And that is why I think retailer is going to be a very key, you know, cog in the wheel in making a brand.
In fact, you know, I just add to what both of you said. I remember reading somewhere that one of the chairman of Coca-Cola Global, and a very complicated name, I don't remember. He was asked in one of those business channels, I think it was CNBC or something, that whatever his name was, that Coca-Cola for the nth year was being voted as the valued as the most valuable brand in the world. He was asked, what is the success behind? What is the story behind this success? Such consistent performance. He had a simple answer. He said, by making more people drink Coke. And I think that's what summarizes what Sudeshna is saying. Finally, it has the consumer will consume when it comes at the retailer's interaction with them. If there are no questions, I would like to first thank the panelists, Sudeshna and Arshad, for taking time out of your busy schedule. You run very important businesses. Thank you for being with us, sharing your expertise and knowledge and experience. And to all of you who found time to be with us on this evening to listen to us, we are trying to bring in our knowledge and expertise and experience in a manner which is easy to understand, so that all of us can pick up something which we can use in our daily lives as we work. Thank you very much. The YouTube, on our Ideas Consulting Group YouTube, you will find the entire recording in a couple of days' time. And thank you so much. Next month, again, we will meet with a new topic with experts to discuss something which we believe is relevant to us. Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Thanks, Deepak. Thanks.
It was wonderful talking to both of you. Just remain safe. It is very, very important. I think now the virus has suddenly woken up.
Thank you so much, Deepak. Thank you. Thanks, Sudeshna.
Thanks, Ashwin.
All the best. Thank you. Have a nice evening.
Bye.